All right, ready to call the meeting to order at 12 o'clock here on Tuesday.
How about 2 o'clock?
How about 2?
Okay, 2 o'clock, that works fine. I need some more coffee.
We call it a, yeah, we're a little late.
Here, government, will we call it a rounding error?
All right, adoption of the agenda.
We need to delete number 5, is sick.
Yep.
And then we need to add.
An executive session on the union contracts at the end. Let's go after the history moment.
Okay, so I would make a motion that we strike number 5, Rick Beatty, from the agenda and add on as, after the history moment, an executive session to discuss the union contract.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, so good. Public comment?
Yeah, Tom Grunewald, Coppinstown Road and Alberta Road. Traffic was improved after you did your first round. This last Lime Rock event was pretty difficult for us. Huge trucks speeding, et cetera, et cetera. I think we need to renew our efforts there. It seems to me that in Salisbury Town, on White Hollow Road, there are center lines on dangerous curves. And it, I don't know that they're going to jail for having done that, but it would certainly be helpful on Coppinstown, because flipping around those corners, those semi-trailers and car vans, et cetera, are a true menace. I see that a lot of work is going on the roads, and the trimming on Coppinstown was overdue and is being done, right? But we have a culvert just below us, just downhill of us, that is really a menace.
That's coming up next.
Good.
But that whole, we just did White Hollow.
Yeah.
Now we're going to decide based on traffic whether to do Coppinstown or West Cornwall, but those areas are on the list and ready to get taken care of.
Because where that, there's a little cone that's stuck there, it's a very dangerous spot.
That whole stretch there is, needs some help.
And having spent a lot of time in Sheffield the last 2 weeks, I noticed that they have really wonderful trash barrels where people coming out of delis and restaurants and so forth can put their garbage and go and admire them. They're quite wonderful and are used, and it would help, I think. My wife's full-time job picking up litter on Coppinstown.
Thank her for it.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Any other public comments? Okay. Approval of the minutes for the 8th and the 12th of September.
I didn't see, I mean, they're quite worried. I did not see anything in the one.
No, I did not either. I think we're fine. I would make a motion that we approve the minutes of September 8th and September 12th, 2014.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay, next up is Linda's Town Clerk Historic Documents Preservation Grant. She does a great job with this grant money to take the town's meeting minutes and enclose them in binders, do things of that nature to preserve these documents. She wishes to continue that through this adoption.
I would make a motion that we empower Brent to execute and deliver the State Historic Documents Preservation Grant on behalf of our municipality.
I will second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye, so carry. Next up is the CLMP Small Business Energy Advantage Program. And the numbers that we have to do with the town garage, the costs, the savings, and the improvements that those will provide.
And did you find out that, I think Krisha communicated to you that Bright Ideas grant can be used towards this to offset it. And we had a conversation at the SEEK meeting about, well, why not save it for a larger ticket item, like if we're able to do some good work over at 67 Main and if it comes to some costs over there. But everyone on SEEK felt a little nervous about how long the Bright Ideas grants would be around.
Okay.
And wanted to take advantage of it. And as Krisha said, 5,000 is 5,000, whether we throw it at this or throw it at that, we're still getting the benefit, so.
Excellent. It pretty much comes out of the, you know, it's either added or subtracted from the CMP bill, so you don't see a large lump sum within these projects, which is nice.
So this is, this has the LED, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yep, that's what they're going for. And the estimated payback period is 3 years. And the estimated cost savings is over $3,000, $3,320. The total project cost is $16,131.09. And then you can throw that five at it and get that down to 11.
It's pretty good.
So I think we're definitely going to come out very well with that, so I'm happy about that. And I was really happy about how much time SEEK took to go through this, and JK Energy Solutions had no idea that SEEK was so interested and involved and engaged in what was going on at the town garage with all the lighting.
And they asked the crew members, which was nice too.
Oh, yes.
Roger did.
Oh, definitely.
That helps a lot.
Yep, Ray especially, because he was using some of those very specific lighted areas for mechanic work, but everyone was asked.
I like that the exterior lighting was done as well as the cell shed exterior interior.
Yep.
It's pretty comprehensive throughout the complex down there, which is good. And what's nice about LED, among other things, is that when you turn it on, the light is bright immediately, which is important. It's unlike some CFLs, which take a while to ramp up, where you get the flicker with cold affecting.
In your house, it's okay, but at the garage.
Yeah, fluorescent lights, you know, you have that issue, and of course, they use a fraction of the energy, and they last a long, long time.
Sure.
So it seems like a good investment.
So the next step then is for you to sign this, is that correct?
Correct.
Same plenty, but do we need to make a motion?
Just in case, so you need a motion to accept?
Okay, I would make a motion that we accept the proposal from JK Energy Solutions for the lighting at the town garage.
I will second that, also saying just big kudos to the SDEC. You know, they're a very on-task group, they do a great job, and they've done really good things for the town, and they continue forging ahead, and we're lucky to have them, so.
True.
I second.
Good.
That's a long second.
Was.
Was.
You bring it on.
That's good.
All right, vote, all those in favor?
Aye.
Do you know when you can get that signed?
Pretty soon, like.
Great.
Next up is tax refund request from Donna, they're both cars. And they're both over pays, one was the plate return, and the other was internal lease, I believe.
I would make a motion that we approve these tax refund requests as submitted.
I will second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Next up is the camera quotes, and I thought the easiest way would be to go over the locations here, which is what would allow us to go back to the three companies and say, this is where we want them, and this is what we want to cover.
Right.
Now give us, you know, equal bids all along. So I made a blank one in case you want to change up what we're looking at. But of those eight, basically we're looking at covering who's coming in, who's making the way to the back, heading this way towards the dog pound itself, this camera, which will probably turn a little bit more towards the gas tanks.
Which one?
This one here?
Okay.
And that way, you get people coming in, but you also protect them, then you get the cross heading this way with this camera, which could possibly identify the driver. Over here, you have this camera off the back of the salt, taking the bays, so we can make sure no one's going to get into the bays. This one covers the door for the employees. And this one heads back this way to cover the whole entire area, capturing people heading back into where the gravel and the pipes are.
Do we need anything here?
We have.
We've got that. I'm.
If you wished.
I don't know. That's why I'm asking.
There's nothing really physical there anymore. We did have, you know, old vehicles stored there that are now being removed.
So there's nothing of value back here?
Correct.
Is there any way to get into the building back here?
Not unless you're gonna come.
Not unless you go through the wall.
I figured, that's what I remembered. There's no door. And there's no way to get.
Snow plowing equipment and stuff over there.
Is there any way to get into the gas tanks over here? From what I remember, this is the only entrance, or it was over here.
It's all in Kendrick.
Yeah, so it's right here, right? Okay.
And they bid on a 16-camera system, so you can add up to 16 on there. So these are just 8, keep the cost down. We could add 2 more, 3 more, 4 more, if you wanna cover those areas. It's all within the system.
All of them are just the top one?
All of them basically had a 16-camera. Well, we can specify what we want. You know, I said going forward, just we need to tell them what we all want from the three companies.
Okay.
Now, is there no camera that's covering the interior of the town garage?
Correct.
No, we're just doing the exterior right now, except for this one, which is doing an interior here.
Right.
That's the only interior.
Understood, because that would be people who would come in and help themselves to the salt and sand.
Well, it's a 16-channel video recorder, but only 8 cameras.
On.
Right.
Right.
So they're saying it's gotten dark a little bit in the corners here. So this should be helpful for them as well, so not just a deterrent, but actually helping them.
What do we currently have for security for the town garage? I mean, break-in alarm system, anything? We don't have any camera in there right now, right? One of the guys specked out an Omni camera for the ceiling.
Right.
But we're not gonna look at that.
The Omni camera was for in here, though.
Was it in there?
Yeah, that was an interior dome. Largely, we locked the entrance, the gate, and we locked the door.
And that's it?
That's.
I don't even think these are locked, are they?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, these doors aren't even locked here. That's a lot of that.
So this is a sort of, it's a little bit after the fact. I mean, we'd see somebody coming and going. If something was missing or something was taken, we've got surveillance that has people coming and going.
Of the LED lights outside that come on, shocking bright light.
Right.
And then the knowledge that this is here, it's going to deter a lot of people from doing wrong.
And we'll put some posting out on the entrance road, right, that there is surveillance camera.
Yeah, we have to.
Operating.
Yeah, we have to. Is your thought that the lights might be enough? Or is your thought, what do we do with all this footage?
No, I think the lights are enough. I just, I wanted to be clear about what form of deterrent we're doing here and what kind of security it gives us as far as apprehending somebody should a break-in take place.
The great thing about technology now is that these are accessible to us at home on our devices.
You log in.
You see anything going on, now you don't, you know, call a selectman, you can call the cops.
Right.
You know, we can. So if we see something that's going on that shouldn't be going on, we immediately can call the state troopers and they can be there.
So we'll be able to see this from our home computer?
If we'd like to, yes. That's the way technology is now because of the internet.
I feel like an old lady at home, we can see it from our home.
Of course, you from your home, or your device, you name it. So it's going to give us the capability to know what's going on there at all times.
Do you remember the news story of the guy who was on vacation, his house was being broken into, and he watched the break-in in real time on his phone?
No, but hope we're
that's
not doing that.
That's the technology.
Watch the break-in.
It was crazy.
Yeah,
and
crazy.
Watched the cops show up and apprehend the burglar while on his phone.
Right.
So yeah, that's where the technology is.
Do you think this one is needed because we have this?
Well, just that's right on the dog pound, so if there's any damage done to the dog pound, we'll know who did it.
But there's also some light being shed here.
That's a
nice pan, though, that there's a big open area there. So it's almost looking out on the ball field that way, and having that vista, I think, is important.
This one right here?
Correct.
This one?
Yep.
Okay.
Well, this for the dog pound, but this one here as well.
Oh, this one out this way.
Yep.
Okay.
I think all three of them.
Okay.
I like the angles on all of the cameras.
Well, think about it. I mean, we got this. You guys just got this today. So think about it, and later in the week, if we agree, then we'll just get the calls to the companies and we'll get this done.
The only thing we might, the postings for the cameras all look good. Mm-hmm. And to your question, Jess, about a little more on the entrance and over here, this camera could also be rotated slightly.
Mm-hmm. Yes, yeah, because you're getting so much light
right
here. So you might, well, actually, yes, because you've got this one.
Correct.
So you could take this one and rotate it out. Okay.
Mm-hmm. I forget what the lens span
is
on those.
But they can change the lens on the fly.
Yeah, it was on the spec.
So if we don't like what we see, we can change the lens to get
right.
a wider.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Call it a fisheye.
Yeah.
I think
preliminary, this looks really good. 1, 2, 3, 4, four, five, six, seven, eight. So it's seven exterior, one interior. Did you show this to the guys?
Not yet, but I can do that.
It would be good to have their feedback on it, because they're the ones that are down there much more often than anybody, so I'd like to know what they think.
We can do that.
Yeah.
Any comments from the crowd? All right, that's the update on that. The next is the update on the road work. And Niblo Hill was done last week. Marty and Progressive did a great job there. And it's a nice update to that road. We got some quotes in on other roads, but obviously that's going to occur next year, not this year. And Dawn Hill's drainage is being done at the end of this week into next week.
Yeah, they've got the big pipes up there off to the side, so they're ready.
So that's very reliable. And the crack sealing and everything else continues.
Am I back to Dawn Hill for a minute? Mm-hmm. Is it correct to say that a lot of the materials that were found for the Dawn Hill drainage were found at the town garage?
Correct.
Great, so that was stuff that we had that we could reuse.
Yeah, right.
Excellent.
So we use a lot of that, which is nice.
Excellent, yeah. I always want to use that first.
Everything else, you know, dirt roads hold up great when it doesn't rain. So
well, it hasn't rained.
It hasn't rained, so we got that going for us.
Okay.
And really and truly, that's about it on the road update front. The guys are doing a nice job, like I said, on White Hollow, clearing up an area where the new roads were in danger. Actually, a much bigger danger than we thought. When we took away the vegetation, we noticed.
Who's working on that?
Our town crew.
Okay.
Upcountry finished up on Jackson Hill this past week.
Yeah, the vegetation can hide what's going on under those shoulders.
Mm-hmm.
And Coffins Down is next on the list, as well as White Hollow heading down. And that should get us in good shape. Then we're heading over to your neck of the woods.
And the crack seal guys, they're still going to do West Cornwall Road, right?
They are.
Because they did it last year, but there's new cracks.
There's a lot of new cracks.
There's a lot of them. And that road just...
It's going to be a big bulk of the work.
There's a lot of traffic on that road. It's a long road.
So you said Jackson Hill is done.
Yes.
And who did Jackson Hill?
Upcountry.
Okay.
They did Jackson Hill, Sharon Mountain Road,
right,
and East Street.
Yeah. And then Cockinstown's next?
The road's height.
And who's doing Cockinstown?
Our group.
Okay. And then White Hollow, the other side.
Right.
Okay. And that's us as well.
That's us as well, unless time's running short and then we'll bring in subsequent. Okay. Any other questions on the roads from the crowd?
Okay. Have we had to use any subcons recently? Are they out doing any projects
just
for us?
Just Upcountry. They finished up the job on Jackson Hill. Did a really nice job.
And of course,
Niblo.
Right.
So yeah, we're using them.
Good.
It's a lot of work.
Yeah. Yeah, we don't know what kind of winter we're going to get, so.
It is true.
Got to keep the hammer down.
All right, next up is the Greenskeeper applicants, saying we got five very solid ones.
Yeah.
This is great. This is going to be a really difficult position.
And we'll begin contacting them and start the process of interviewing them.
Right. So were these the only ones that were submitted?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So of every one that was submitted, each one of them was strong.
Mm-hmm.
That's great.
Yeah. And Betsy Hall is going to be part of the process.
Excellent.
So that's always a good thing.
Do we know when we're doing those?
I'll contact them as soon as tomorrow, just to see what their schedules are.
Okay.
And then any other questions about the Greenskeepers?
I think it's great that we have this interest in it. It speaks well of how people feel about the green.
True.
They got to know it's a daunting job, and you got to love it to really own it. And we've got some good experienced people here.
I think we have four out of five of these look to me to be from Sharon.
One former Sharon resident.
Yeah, and one former, so that's
pretty good. Okay, next up is STEEP grants. And the STEEP grants got bumped up into this calendar year. They need to be in by November 28th, which puts the onus on us to find steep grants to submit quickly, but also that fall within what the steep grants are in terms of what they...
Can you refresh our memory as to what the focus is this year on steep grants?
Underlying.
Yeah, I was gonna go online and check that out.
As we continue to recover from the economy, preference this year will be given to projects that promote economic development, emergency preparedness, and/or infrastructure repair. Okay. What kind of infrastructure? Roads?
Yeah, probably.
Only capital projects will be considered, so you'd have to be building them, I guess.
Okay.
Well, of the two in town that I've asked right away for wanting to submit, is the Park and Rec again, they want to resubmit the field house.
I talked to Donna, yeah, she said they want to go for it again.
And the fire department, Stan asked that we consider his project, which was for elevators and handicap access for the fire.
Do they have a ready application for them?
They have had applications in the past, but I'm sure they have the ready for this specific steep.
Right.
The one thing about this year that's different than the past is that it has to be put in electronically, which can be difficult. We always find somebody that has that skill to do so.
Refresh my memory, do we have to choose then? I mean, do we have to, we have to decide which one we want to submit for?
Based on...
It depends on how much money.
Which can only do total $500.
Right, so...
Did you break it up?
Right.
Right. I mean, we know that the field house had a price tag of at least $400,000 when we submitted it the last time.
In that way, we also have the low SIP still available, so we have to keep that in consideration.
Right, but just thinking, we are gonna end up having to make a choice here what we submit.
Right.
Do they, do you know if Park and Rec is gonna review that steep grant application that they submitted and were rejected for it in order to maybe tweak it so that it's a little bit more in line with this?
Right.
Okay.
Not something the state will put out, that's the important thing.
Right, excellent. Carol Asher also said that she'd be willing to help again.
Good.
They need her, so...
And she was solid.
Okay. All right, good.
So, that's steep. Any questions about the steep from the public?
Have you seen the online, Brent, how daunting is it? Have you looked at the online?
It's the same as, have you seen the other ones?
And the required fields?
I think it's the same as the other ones, isn't it?
You have to sign up for an account, there's an online PDF, you need the latest and greatest PDF, that's usually what gets you.
Yeah.
The latest and greatest PDF in order to get into the system, so it's good to check with them first to see what version they're using.
Right.
And they come, sometimes they do it on the fly, so you gotta download it, make sure you have it.
But I think the application is the same.
Yeah, it really changes.
If you've seen it before, it's...
Adobe version, $2,500,000.
True. All right, so flying right along. The history moment today is kind of a hybrid, but again, it focuses on the green, and because we had the greenkeeper applicants come in, our green is pretty amazing, and just recently, I do a lot of work with Mark Twain, and because I do work with Mark Twain, I got to know Helen Keller. Now, there was a man associated with Mark Twain just up the road from here, where Mo Dore lives now, his name was Frank J. Sprague. Now, he's the father of modern-day electric traction, so he came up with elevators, trolley cars, you name it. A woman contacted me last week and let me know that there's a good chance, based on what she's been researching, that Helen Keller may have visited here in Sharon to see Frank J. Sprague. So I thought that was kind of neat. This particular photo here shows Helen at her house in Easton, Connecticut, and what's neat about the blind back then was that they didn't have seeing eye dogs, and what she had configured around her house were these networks of trees that were almost like a network that allowed her to walk around her property and experience nature without the aid of anyone else. So these types of rails led from her house all the way down out into her fields, and she did have dogs, except her dogs were just synthetic pets. And this is a neat one because it's a rare color photo of Helen Keller.
Wow.
At her property. And this is from the American Foundation for the Blind in New York City. So, have a neat connection that we could possibly add to the Sharon history. The other thing, just down from there on the property that we now know is the Buckley property, was Noah Webster came to Sharon in around 1780, and he taught school here. He had gone to school in Litchfield, become a lawyer, and he got into schooling here in Sharon, and it was within his time here that he came up with the American Spelling Book, and that became known as, what was known as the blue-backed book. And what was neat about it is that he came to the conclusion that kids needed books from America, and most of our books at that time period were coming from Britain, and he didn't think that it made any sense. So he came up with not only spelling, but pronunciation, arithmetic writing, and that all pretty much is interesting to me because it happened primarily here in Sharon, Connecticut, the idea at least. Included in his class of 1778 was Noah Webster, Joel Barlow, and Oliver Wolcott. Pretty solid class. From so I thought that was kind of neat. This was the building as it stood about the time when it was going to be given to the Historical Society. It never made it there, but it's a neat connection to our history to have the fatherly dictionary here in Sharon. So many neat stories in this town. So that's the history moment. And that's the public portion of our meeting today.
Thank you.
Sure. We're going to executive session.
Thank you, Tom, for letting us know about the never-ending traffic issues.